I felt a very great wish to see him again, and one evening I ventured to ask permission to go up to the green. The jailer was gone out. The turnkey opened the door and led me there, where I found Marshal Ney and Mr. Gameau. I joined them. It was about 3 months after our first conversation. At that period, all his delusions seemed to have vanished. Le Bedoyer, said he, has crossed the fatal passage. Now it will be your turn, my dear Lavalette, and mine afterwards. It is all one, I answered, who fall first. I know there is no hope left. Oh, that we shall see. However, all these lawyers annoy me. They do not understand my situation, but I shall speak for myself. Time passes very slowly in prison. I did not know what to do with myself. I was discontented without reason with my situation and uneasy in respect to my poor Emily. Each day brought me worse and worse accounts of her health. I had obtained her promise that she would not come to see me before her accouchement. The visit might have killed her. My time so ill employed in seeking to discover the future, in exhausting all conjectures, in cursing the new revolution, threw me into a fatal dejection. I felt the want of raising my spirits by the only diversion I was permitted to take, reading. I sent for Hume's History of England. When I perused the narrative of all the royal misfortunes with which it is filled, I found my own more bearable, and I reaped both courage and comfort from it. Finally, in recurring to my own situation, I rested on the idea that it was not possible I could be sentenced to capital punishment, and that I should certainly come off with a few years' imprisonment. This prospect was not cheerful, but as I entertained the hope of being confined in one of the prisons of Paris, I might see my family, comfort them, and put my affairs in order. I also frequently thought of the scaffold, but only as a vague threat that could never be realized. I was in the abode of crime, and I often figured to myself the terrors of a thief, and especially of a murderer, awaking in the night at the fancied cries of his victims, and struggling in vain under the hands of the executioner. What must not his sufferings be? As for me, I could at least return without remorse to the 20th of March. The indignation of the sovereign, the anger of his adherents, could not make my heart beat more quickly. I felt myself strong against their vengeance, and I escaped from it in imagination by following the emperor in a solitary bark on his way to St. Helena. I also took a fancy to know who were my new compatriots in this strange country, for the conciergerie is like a distant region separated from all civilized nations, a sort of colony of the New World, governed by brutal and despotic laws, and whose population consists only of the dregs of society, and where ferociousness and depravity must be constantly watched and repressed. To penetrate into that region, passports are with difficulty obtained, and many humiliating forms must be observed. The prisoner can see his relations, friends, and counsel only across double bars, which keep them at several feet distance, surrounded by turnkeys who are the privileged spies of his words and most trivial gestures, and who trifle with the most painful feelings by enjoining them a rigorous silence. I took great pains to obtain any information. The turnkeys could not answer any questions, but from my own observations, I think there must have been, at the time of my confinement, about 50 prisoners. They slept in about 20 rooms containing each 5 or 6 beds, for which they paid 10 francs a month. This was called being a la pistole. Those who did not possess the means of paying passed the night in a sort of shed on straw, very seldom renewed. The greatest part of these wretches were doomed to the galleys, and most of them had committed theft or forgery. Their indifference as to the fate that awaited them was quite inconceivable. Not to deprive Madame Lavalette of the services of my manservant, I had accepted for myself those of a condemned prisoner who was respited for a few months. He had filled a responsible employment in one of the government offices and had embezzled the money that passed through his hands, for which crime he was to go for 6 years to the galleys. He was a spy over me. His honeyed words and affected officiousness inspired me with a great disgust, and affected officiousness inspired me with a great disgust. But on the one hand, my pity for his fate that seemed to frighten him, and on the other, my fear of getting, instead of him, one still more perverse, determined me to keep him. At last, however, a perfidious trick he played to some others became the cause of our separation. He slept with 6 other prisoners in a room situated in the western part of the edifice. These wretches took it into their heads to get out of prison by digging a hole in the wall 12 feet thick, and so to escape on the Quai des Lunettes. My honest servant procured them one of those large iron bars called by the prisoners, I believe, chancelier. But he had begun by betraying them, and the jailer let them go on for some time in their work. Every night they filled their pockets with the rubbish, and in the morning they cleverly dispersed it in the yard. To arrive at the outward hall, they were obliged to take out and replace every night an enormous stone of 6 feet in length. They had been already for several months at work, and they only wanted one night more to regain their liberty when the jailer came to pay them his visit, and all was easily discovered. The traitor was, in appearance, condemned to the same punishment that was inflicted on them all. But his companions were not to be duped by this, and the jailer told me that he ran the risk of being murdered in the galleys. It would be even difficult to let him travel thither with them. The galley slaves never pardon among one another a treachery of that sort. 10 years would not be sufficient to make them forget it. The yard of the female prisoners was, as I have said, facing my window and separated from it by a high wall. That circumstance was a continued source of annoyance to me. From 8 in the morning to 7 in the evening, I was stunned by a deluge of the most vulgar, coarse, and depraved expressions in the French language. The turnkeys were frequently obliged to go and restore good order among those harpies. It was on this yard that the 2 windows of the Queen's prison opened. During my confinement, that chamber, situated on my passage when I went to the Green, served as a speaking parlor for those privileged prisoners who were allowed to receive visits from their friends. It was a large room divided in 2 by a sort of pillar that formed 2 arches. The floor was paved with bricks placed on the thick side and must have been very old, as the figures they represented are long since out of use. The entrance was at the bottom of a dark passage. The Queen had only a miserable bed, a table, and 2 chairs. A large piece of tapestry that hung across the room separated her from the gendarme and the jailer, who, however, left her during the night. How many times have I not walked up and down in that prison when grief and lowness of spirits used to oppress me? There I found strength and courage. I blushed to complain of the fate that might be preparing for me when I recollected the horrible destiny of a queen of France. I was certainly the first person who openly expressed the wish that this dungeon might be converted into a chapel. A short time after my escape, the order was really given and executed. The jailer, with his obsequious manners, began to weary me, and his everlasting questions, his long narratives of prison adventures, became quite insufferable. He used to come 8 or 10 times a day and interrupt me while I was reading or meditating. I was imprudent enough to speak in his presence of chess, and from that instant I was obliged every evening to let myself be beaten during 3 hours by him. A circumstance of small importance happily delivered me of that bore. He had been at a former period verger of the criminal court, and he had sold his office to a man who could not pay him. Having heard that I was particularly acquainted with Monsieur Pasquier, then keeper of the seals, he begged me to write a few words to Madame Lavalette that she might solicit for him permission to resume his office. She, however, being rather mistrustful, was convinced that under his claim might be some dangerous plot against me, and she sent my letter to the Minister of Police. De casis. Communication of that sort with the prisoners are wholly prohibited, so the jailer was sent away. This was very fortunate for us at the time of my escape. Having been born and bred in a prison, he was full of artifice, sagacity, and penetration. He would undoubtedly have observed my disguise, and all would have been lost. They put in his place a man from Bordelais, a protege of Mr. De Casas. This man was of a harsh humor, his manners were severe and even rude, and he was very enthusiastic in his political opinions. He wanted at first to imitate his predecessor, to come into my room at all times and enter into conversation with me, but I took such a high tone with him that I silenced him the very first day. Consequently, I only used to see him in the morning and in the evening when he came to examine whether all was right. I had chosen Monsieur Tripier for my counsel, whom I did not know, and he had taken for his assistant Monsieur Lacroix Franville. My friends had a great desire that I might be forgotten and frequently expressed a wish that I might fall sick. Count Alexander de la Rochefoucauld, who came very often to see me, continually reproached me with my looking too well. If you were ill, he said, and obliged to keep your bed, they would be forced to put off your trial. Time would be by degrees, calm passion, and your friends would do the rest for you. I was certainly of his opinion, but where was I to find an illness? I could not come to the resolution of breaking one of my legs or arms, and one cannot have, just at the time one wishes, an inflammation on the lungs or the stomach. I was therefore under the necessity of keeping my health, and with it all the dangers of my situation. It was at last decided that I should be examined by one of the judges of the Royal Court, and Monsieur Dupuis was chosen for my reporter. I had several years before frequently dined with him at the house of a mutual friend. When I came before him, we knew each other again. The presence of the registrar kept me silent. The magistrate appeared to me to be moved by generous compassion, but as the examination went on, he was soon convinced that he need not observe any particular delicacy in regard to me. I took the advance on the required explanation. I urged them on in all possible ways, and the first examination lasted 5 hours, though he wanted several times to stop it, thinking I might be fatigued. But I felt myself so completely innocent. I laid so much importance on destroying all prepossessions, all superstructure of false imputations which filled the indictment, that I should have continued for 2 hours longer if he had wished it. The next day, we had another sitting, which lasted again 4 hours. I have heard from my friend that Monsieur Dupuis did not conceal his surprise at the importance that was attached to my business, and that at the news of my being condemned, he expressed his indignation with a generous frankness. 2 months elapsed, I believe, between this examination and my trial, but time did not alleviate the hatred to which I was exposed. My friends were discouraged at the violence of the Paris drawing room against me. The royalists were enraged at the recollections of their unworthy conduct in the month of March, and sought to cover their shame by the imaginary plot which they said had brought back the emperor. And they appeared to have no doubt but that I had been at the head of the undertaking. According to them, a very active correspondence had taken place with the island of Elba during the 11 months of the first reign, and all the old clerks of the post office had taken a part in it. The mails which went to the south of France were filled with letters for me. Head clerks, under clerks, couriers, postmasters in all departments, all had been in the secret and had abetted my design. To tell the truth, if I had been the chief contriver of such a plan, I might claim credit for it. Its conception and execution would have ensured me everlasting fame. I should have been the most profound of all conspirators, and I might pretend to a great part of the glory which people too frequently bestow on men who have made themselves famous by great enterprises, even when their aim is contrary to morals and humanity. But nothing must go before the truth. In 1814, I had carefully avoided all connection with the clerks of the post office. With my ardent wish for seeing the emperor again, I mixed no thought of ambition. The love cherished for him by France, the conviction I shared with the country, that he alone could govern her and place her on a solid footing in the first rank among the nations of the globe. The hope that to all the benefits he had already bestowed on her, he would also add the restitution of her liberties. And finally, a deep feeling of gratitude were the only motives for my conduct. 1,000 others in my place would have done as much. Millions have been led on by the same impulses. On his road, at his arrival, the people pressed forward to meet him. The greatest in the land had rushed to serve him, as well as those whom the Bourbons had discarded, as those whom they had retained. One lost battle had decided our fate, but if victory had remained faithful to us, the empire, reestablished on its true foundation, would have repulsed for a long time and perhaps forever the family of the Bourbons. And thus liberty would have undoubtedly found her place with glory and peace. I was very much afraid that during my confinement there would be some execution. The condemned cell was next to mine at the bottom of the yard where I used to walk. Two persons accused of murder were tried but acquitted. One of them was a young man who had served in the lifeguards. He had murdered his mistress in cold blood after having passed the night with her. The particulars of his crime were horrible. He first fired a pistol at her, then discharged one at himself, but his own wound was slight. He was acquitted, as I have said, that they brought him back to the vestibule adjoining my dungeon, where he was to wait until the accustomed forms had been gone through to set him at liberty. I was not yet made acquainted with the verdict when cries and sobs struck my ear. I thought he had been condemned, and I must confess that my courage was greatly shaken. It was not until 2 hours afterwards that I was told that joy had produced on him a violent nervous attack. Fortunately, his fear of passing another night in prison gave him strength enough to go away. The other prisoner was a woman who was accused of having pushed her invalid sister into the river where she had been drowned. This unfortunate person edified even the jailer with her good behavior so that he employed rigorous means to prevent her odious companions from extending their abuse into real outrages. The day she was tried, she dressed herself with particular care. When she left the court, she fainted, but her joy was moderate. And on leaving the prison, she wished to distribute among her wretched companions some marks of her benevolence. But as the money she possessed did not make a considerable sum, she sent to beg 10 francs of me to add to the present she made to them, saying that she would pray to God that I might find as equitable a jury as hers had been. When the time of my solitary confinement was over, some friends came to visit me. In the foremost rank, I must place Count Alexander de la Rochefoucauld, whose constant friendship never ceased softening my sufferings and who gave me an affecting proof of it by accepting the charge of subrogé tuteur to my wife during her illness, and Monsieur de Vendeuil, at present a member of the Chamber of Deputies. As he was obliged to go down to the country and remain there all the autumn, he put one day into my hand 200 gold louis, begging me to keep them, saying, "Your communications with your family may become difficult, and money can never do any harm. It is better for you to have some now in your possession than to be obliged to ask for it." And indeed, these 200 louis were of great service to me when I fled to Bavaria 2 months afterwards. His mother had been an angel of kindness to my wife. It was she who brought her the first consolation in her prison. Colonel Briqueville, who was not yet cured of two wounds he received in the affair of Versailles, frequently left his bed to come and talk with me for several hours together. I owe also many thanks to Messieurs Frank O'Haggerty and de Fidier for the marks of attachment they lavished on me. But the most active friend of all was one of our relations, Tascher de St. Roses, aide-de-camp to Prince Eugène. This excellent young man, though suffering from an asthmatic complaint which from his childhood never allowed him to sleep in a bed, and the attacks of which put him regularly twice a month in the most imminent danger, used to come and pass whole days with me. The charms of his conversation and the gentle cheerfulness of his temper made me forget at once my dungeon and my future fate. He continually maintained that I would be sentenced to banishment, and he pressed me to accompany him to Martinique, where he was born. He painted to me with the enthusiasm of a colonist. Its beautiful climate, its cool shades, the various pleasures its inhabitants enjoyed, the singularity of their manners, and the attentions I should meet with from a numerous family of which he was the favorite. He sung to me Negro songs. He talked the sweet jargon of the Negro women and thus took a pleasure in preparing for me, my wife, and her child a happy life in the New World.